predecessors about a century ago were still fighting to be called persons allowed to practice. And Regina Guha and Sudhanshu Bala Hazra fought the battle and lost it. Only till Cornelia Saurabhji made the mark, and after that it has been a long journey. We are all standing on their shoulders, and today we are here proudly presenting the honorable judges as panelists. And of course, we have 9 judges in our lady judges. It sounds a big number, but it's still a far cry from what we want. And get started with the questions. Nobody needs it. The panelists need no introduction, really, but as a formal part of the proceedings, I would love to introduce Honorable Mrs. Justice Pushpa Satyanarayana. Can we please have her video?
Again, you're not audible.
Because every time I need to mute.
Yeah, you can start. Yeah. Welcome. Please complete the first question. Let the panel discussion start.
Okay, sure. As everybody, it's a widely acknowledged fact that women never lose in an argument. At least that's what every married man says. And yet, why is it that the legal profession is not a natural one for all women to take up to? And why is it still a male bastion? This is the first question.
Before that, I'll just explain the agenda. That is the question. That will be the first question. This question, I request the honorable panelists to discuss among themselves, come up with how much ever ideas and suggestions that you have. And then once you complete the discussion of the first issue, we will move on to the second issue. That is the agenda. Yes, Maithili, you can repeat the question once again.
So do I get it? Please explain. So it means that each one of us to answer the question. Give you our viewpoint of the area.
That's right. That's right.
And more than that, if I may say this, it's more of for the three of you to discuss the issue and put your viewpoints on this together. Not really an answer to the questions. It's more like this is a thought.
All right. Yes, we get it.
Discuss.
Yes. Yeah. Very happy morning to you all. Today, unusual from the usual, we had a very heavy downpour in the morning, making the very morning really very pleasant. So that's perhaps all the women have now joined together. Yes. So now coming to your question, Maithili, you say that the argument of a woman succeeds only at home and not outside. Am I right? Did I get
not
you right?
Not really. I'm saying quite the opposite. I would say that women are known to be, everybody says they are always winning all arguments, and yet why is it they're not in larger numbers in the legal profession? Is it a natural thing?
On a lighter note, yes. The reason why it's men only argue, we women discuss.
Ah, right.
Sure. No. See, otherwise also, if you have seen all those jokes about wives, it is always that the argument is won by the wife and not by the husband. And now the jokes have been pouring in the wake of the COVID now. See, like the famous author, the utopian thinker, the Ayn Rand says, the question is not who is going to let you go, but who is going to stop us? So there's nobody to stop us. It is for you. See, and when you say that, why are there not more number of persons, women as lawyers or judges? Am I right? That's what you're asking.
Yes, it is.
What we have to go ahead with. And why should we say that we are not in many number? If you go take the statistics today, the student population, the girls are outnumbering the boys in any law school.
Yes.
There has been a complete culture transformation now. from what when I studied and passed out of the college and how it is today. I think, Asha, you would agree with me.
Exactly. I do.
So the culture transformation also helps a lot for women nowadays, that they have more number of women are getting into this legal profession and they are competing with men with much more competency. And I would never say that women are not doing very well or we are not given our share. It is for us to take. It is there. Yes.
Thank you very much. That's a very empowering statement. This is exactly what we need to do.
Very positive start.
Exactly. Positive. And it is exactly, I fully agree that one should stop feeling like victims if you want to be victors. So I think that is, you made a wonderful point, and I think that is what youngsters and all women aspiring to the top should keep in mind.
Unless Anita has some other take on it, I also have an added point to that. See, the legal profession is a very old profession. It has been a male bastion all through. And when the legal profession actually started, women were not even educated. Yes. See, you look at all the fields where women and men have started together. Take the IT department, take the education department, take the banks. Wherever women and men have started at the, you know, the starting point at the same time, women have surged ahead. As far as the legal profession is concerned, we started late, but we are catching up. So I don't think the women lawyers or the women should feel that we are nowhere near the mark. We have created impact.
It is fantastic to hear.
Yes, Anita Jay.
You speak about storming a bastion. And it is in that context that you refer to Winnie. In my view, storming a bastion is not just about winning an argument, particularly in the context of the profession. There are so many things that one has to do if you're looking at ultimately storming that bastion. Entry, for one. Sustaining yourself in that field. And then winning. All these are things that together will result in someone storming a bastion or otherwise. And in fact, as Pushpa was saying, I was looking at some statistics. And if you look at the aspirants for legal studies in 2017, it was 42% in terms of girls versus boys. In 2018, it increased to 43 point something. And then in 2019, a further increase. And if you talk to interns who work with us, we find that the ratio of girls to boys in classes are also much more, as is their performance quotient. The performance quotient is also sometimes better. I would not want to make any controversial statements in terms of that. But I would only say that as Frost said, we have miles to go, but we are very surely but steadily reaching.
Yes. As your lordship rightly put it, there have been a lot of girls who are coming into the legal profession. The number of entrants into the law colleges are definitely more these days. Can the others mute, please? Excuse me, can you please mute yourself? Yes. So when I was just saying that, of course, as students there are many. But once they come into the legal profession, as we all know, all of us have gone through this, this initial years of gestation period, there is a lot of waiting period. And some of them, of course, like us, like your lordships also, who have gone to the, have reached monumental heights. You have surpassed all that and you have crossed that particular gestation period, that waiting period, wherein, sometimes there is simultaneous entry into matrimony also. But what happens is some of them, although they have a lot of interest while entering into the profession, it kind of wanes after a particular point of time because of the gestation period. And what is the advice that the honorable panelists would give to the the upcoming lawyers, lady lawyers, who should not leave the profession just because they have other commitments? What is your experience and what is your word of advice to them?
See, the lawyers, the female lawyers especially, are mistaken for non-lawyers. They are, if it is a firm, you know, nowadays it is only more firms, like unlike where we were groomed in a Gurukulam setup. So they are only treated as non-lawyers and they are made to do office housework, I put it that way. And the female lawyers are used mainly for organizing the meetings, organizing the parties and do the back office work many a time. And if they come to the forefront, like what you said, if the panelists who are now today on the bench have really fought the times and come ahead, I did personally have certain experiences. Like, you know, for a lawyer, a woman lawyer, assertiveness and the self-promotion is definitely is what is warranted. And if you be, am I audible?
Yes, absolutely.
If you be assertive, you know, it is not well received by the, I don't want to make any controversial statement again. So the chauvinistic profession, which it was, not now, right? So the assertiveness, it was always criticized, calling you that you never behave ladylike. Supposing you are not assertive, once again you are criticized that you are not, you know, very firm in your arguments. So either way, we are at the receiving ends. So there requires your self-promotion. And as Aparna said, there is certainly a long gap for the gestation period and in the society, which from where we have evolved, at least now, marriage is a must. So when you get into your family system, it is certainly difficult for a woman to balance both the personal life as well as the official life. And the tolerance level, that was what was taught to us when we were not in a nuclear family. We all come from a joint family. So the culture, that is, once again, I reiterate that. So the transformation of the culture from the joint to the nuclear family has taken away the tolerance level from the people. So that is why if you turn around to see, even in the family courts, any profession, very well knowing what is the legal profession, even lawyers married are there at loggerheads before the family court. Why? So that is because the way you are groomed, and the you are not able to strike a balance between the domestic front and the office front. So when you lose on that,
yes,
you are unable to climb on the steps. So that is number one. Even on the professional front also, you know, even when I was a junior, when I used to be very assertive in the arguments, it was not very well received. And they don't expect a woman to argue. So sometimes, you know, it is not always that you can tide over that and come. Sometimes that puts you off. So many a times, you know, say, oh, this is going to be a tough profession. Why would you, after all, stick on to that? So that will be the mindset of a woman. Then she would walk out of the profession. Yes, Sasha.
Anita.
Anita. She's not seen on the screen.
Anita's hiding.
No, I'm here. Are you not able to see me?
You're not on the screen.
You're not on the screen.
You're on the screen. Why?
Charu, why don't you put the judges in the front panel? Can you do that?
I can see. She's
there. You're heard.
The judges and the moderators are on video. Everyone else is off. So if you can just see an icon at the top right hand side corner, there is something called grid view.
Yeah, grid view is there. We are all on grid view only. But I think you'll have to slide the screen a bit. Then you can see. Yeah. When you slide it, she's there.
I'm not able to see her.
No, you will have to slide, Asha.
Not speaking, you will come automatically to the front panel.
No, if you can put her onto our own, this grid, can't you move her to the grid where we are? So that we, three of us, we see each other. It would be very convenient.
I think if Lordship starts speaking, she will come to the front panel. That is.
If I may just clarify here, host does not have a control in the order in which the video is displayed. displayed. So as and when the panel becomes active, it will automatically show up.
All right. Yes, Anita, then you'll have to speak up.
Yes. So your question was about balancing home and professional front. Was that the question?
The question is, balancing, of course, is one of the points. But there are also women who leave by choice because of the long gestation period, and they are not able to get over that due to many factors. One of them could be the family also. That is my question. Get over it.
See, long gestation period is a corollary of the profession. Yes. I think that that would be something that affects all practitioners, whether one is a male or a female. One has to go through the process of gestation to establish themselves and reach a particular point. No doubt, there are very peculiar situations that only a woman would have to face in this. And the family can be a boon, or it can be a factor that would result in the woman having to step away from the profession. If we are looking for, we are all agreed on the position that this is a given as of now. This is the situation, the reality on the ground. So one would have to see what we can do going forward to perhaps remedy and make it better. And in my view, the most important thing that we need to do is to sensitize men within our circle to ensure that there is a level playing field going forward. Children at home, our sons, the men folk, we will have to start from home, sensitize them to ensure that there is a level playing field going forward. As far as all other things, points that have been made by the earlier speakers, those are in fact, they are facts. They are realities. So one hardly needs to repeat them. But we can remedy that over a period of time. It's not something that can be done overnight or cold turkey. But this is how one has to make a start. Start at home, sensitize them now, and going forward, I'm sure we will see it.
That's a beautiful point.
Yes, and if I may take it forward on the same note, exactly what I was talking about, gender stereotypes. Don't we have to break the gender stereotype? Because what women till now, the successful women have been doing is overdoing their domestic responsibilities so that no one raises a finger and says, look, you're a career woman, we have allowed you to pursue your career, and therefore nobody should say you have fallen short of the standards that a housewife could meet. So women are being superwomen, which should not be necessary at all. It is a matter of understanding each other and to create a greater sensitivity on how it is always a woman who is able to pursue, or any human is able to pursue their ambition, their dreams, is a better person at the end of the day because they are satisfied with what they are doing. And for that, they don't need to, have to do some heroic balancing beyond what is required when somebody else can step in. So that is where, if we overdo our superwoman bit, we may be conveying, sending out a wrong message. What would you say about that?
Before that, I think Asha Jay has to tell her views on
it. I'm sorry.
Asha Jay has to on that.
What Pushpa Jay and Anita had, I am single and free. So I have not had this balancing effect, balancing problem. As far as the profession is concerned, one thing I feel is, why do we get into, when you are a lawyer, you are a lawyer first and then a lawyer. So, when you get into the profession, if you get into the profession with the feeling that you are a woman lawyer, therefore it is that I have to prove myself, then I think that's the wrong way you start off. Been lucky. I have got into an office where I was never treated as a woman. A lawyer, I was treated as a lawyer. I was given equal responsibility. I think Pushpa Jay and I come from offices where we have been given a lot of responsibilities. In fact, both of us had taken over, we were managing the offices. despite the fact that there were men around, but
yes,
managed the offices. So we were treated equally in the offices. Now the question is balancing. Now balancing is not only in the legal profession. You take any profession. Today, we nuclear families have come to stay. We have a lot of our male lawyers who also help in the household activities. They also, yes, you know, take their children to schools. And also it is a balancing factor which has been taken by both the male as well as the female. Gone are the days where it was only the woman who was in the kitchen. Now you do have households where the work is being shared. Yes, there are societal mindsets which say that, you know, women can't be too assertive. But I think we have all managed. We have never, what do I say? We have in our own way, we have created a niche in the profession. I don't think the three of us, I don't think any one of you could say that we were argumentative, very assertive.
Asha, just a minute. You only said we all have managed to come up, right? So that is why what I meant as our tolerance. We thought, despite all this, the gender discrimination or the work balance or the sexual harassment, of course, which we never had, and the gender wage pay also.
Yes.
Despite all that, we have managed to come up. You coined the right word, managed. See, it is not that everybody can manage. That is what I think Maithili was referring to. How do you get over, tide over this? Because once Aparna was saying about this gestation. See, when a woman goes for her gestation period, it may range anywhere between 6 months to 1 year or even a little more than that, depending upon her family circumstances. There are cases where I have personally witnessed. If a female lawyer has not been attending office for some reason for 2 months or so, very quickly they say, no, she has left the profession.
Yeah. Yes, we feel.
They only, yes. So it is a cutthroat competition in the legal profession also. See, those lawyers, especially women who have passed and taken up practice, they're exceptionally doing very well. And they have also really come up very well in their career.
Thank you.
The obstacles, what I meant, the gender bias, the gender discrimination, the sexual harassment, the work-life balance, and also the gender wage gap. Those four things have to be addressed now for any woman lawyer to be very successful.
Now, talking about, let's move from this gender discrimination to gender equality. We're talking about gender equality, we can even term it as gender neutrality. Are we talking in terms of proportionate representation of women qua men, or are we talking about the recognition or the evaluation of our work? That is, our work is being evaluated. Is that so? Or is it a beautiful marriage of these two? That is, there should be proportionate representation as well as achievement in terms of work. What is your take on that, the Honorable Panel?
I would quickly say that it is a curse that the entire Indian system has to go by reservation and giving percentage. You go by merit. That is what I think Aparna was trying to point out.
Yes, absolutely.
The general neutrality, and if you are competing with men, and if you go by merit, I 100% vouch that women would surpass men. Absolutely. If anyone has got a different view, can express.
Yes, and in terms of the legal profession also, your lordship may kindly say that, because in my personal view, I feel that the legal profession is actually an outstanding profession where, irrespective of the proportional representation, we have seen a lot of achievers. Your lordships are standing examples for that. So that is my personal view. Your lordships may share your views.
Of course, goes without saying. See, like how I said, we women have had a slow start as far as this profession is coming. We have come in late, but though we have come late, we are moving forward quite quickly. Look at the number of girls. It's so nice to see in our court halls when we see a lot of women lawyers come and represent, especially the youngsters, who are doing exceptionally well. We feel, you know, we feel quite pleased about it. The number of entrants, not only into the college, we also find that there are quite a number of girls who are entering the profession, and we find that many of them are sticking on. So that, I guess, will definitely bring down this divide, or should I say the gap between the men ratio.
Gender neutrality, dream. Let's hope it's not a pipe dream. It's a dream. But we'll have to be cognizant of the fact that we don't have that as on date. So the utopian situation or the ideal situation is that, yes, things should be gender neutral. Things should go solely by merit. I cannot subscribe enough to that. But we will have to balance that with the situation where there will have to be some impetus given to increase representation of women. Perhaps that need not be simply an increased representation per se, but maybe there could be more of a conscious decision to bring in women who would be capable, efficient, and competent, so that over the years, the gap becomes more and more. My take as far as this question on gender neutrality is concerned. There was an earlier question asked on the Superwoman.
Yes.
Or the Wonder Woman. Yes. I think maybe I just have a few lines to say on that. See, that's a very relative term. Each of us in our minds should believe that we are Superwoman.
Yes.
Whatever it is that we choose to be. And it's not necessary that we have to wear 10 hats to be Superwoman. You wear a single hat, or you wear two hats, or you wear three hats. You do what you do under that hat as best as you can. That makes you a Superwoman. So I think in many circumstances, there is a situation where we are forced to be Superwomen or Wonder Women by society. But there is also a situation where we force ourselves to overreach. We sometimes bite off more than we can chew. And that's a choice that we make. So perhaps women have also to be more conscious about what we want to do, what we can do, and how we are going to set about achieving that. That's some introspection that each one of us have to do to then arrive at our own definition of what kind of a Superwoman or a Wonder Woman we are.
See, and one,
that's beautiful.
Just a minute. There's one more addition. Work. There is absolutely no substitute for hard work. If you are going to really work hard, you will be recognized, whether you're a man. If you are not going to work hard, even if you're a man, you'll be just thrown aside. So I guess basically that is the underlying principle. As far as a lawyer is concerned, we have to work harder.
Correct.
Yes, so basically what the honorable panel is trying to say is that as women, it also applies equally to men, as rightly put. See, we have to make up our minds to really succeed in whatever we do, whether it is a legal profession or any other profession for that matter. And of course, there are impediments in the pathway. So that should be somehow surpassed. Is that what the panelists are saying?
Yeah, absolutely.
As Justice Anita put it, you have to sensitize your own people at home, be it your husband, son, or, and even if they say something jocularly, you know, so the ego clash comes. I mean, to on a lighter vein, I simply say that now today I am a sitting judge. So, you know, the comment what I get my husband is, you're unable to take a decision fast. What is this? Even though every woman will have a difficulty when you open your wardrobe to wear which sari to decide to wear today.
Absolutely.
So, even for that, you know, there'll be the comment from behind is that you're just not able to take a decision quickly. So, I say that is why I have been elevated as a judge to take only decisions. Yes. So, therefore, see, now how you view this, I cannot feel offended and fight with him. No, I'm a better decision maker, this and that. See, that has to be taken it in the right spirit. So, I mean, this is only off record. I'm just saying. See, there are three things That is, one is the, I call it always as a she imperative, S-H-E. The yes stands for the woman's security, her safety. And the H stands for her human rights, or you can even say her rights. And the E is her empowerment.
Beautiful.
So the she imperative, that is what we are now traveling towards. See, for being empowered, you need not necessarily be a lawyer, or you should have been elevated as a judge of the High Court. Even an ordinary person can be empowered. See, the standing example is that lady in Karnataka, the Makka, who has been planting trees. And today she has been conferred with the Padma Shri Award. What best you want to know, have? She had received that award from the President of India going in barefoot, if you have all noticed that ceremony. And she is not educated. And the one person from Trichy, a remote village from Trichy, I know, she has constructed a toilet. She is a coolie. She is a daily wager. From the out of the money she saved, she has constructed toilets for the public. Just creating an awareness. That I would call it as an empowerment. You the big education or your degrees what you obtain will not help you to get empowered. The attitude, the thought that a woman can achieve anything, that is what is called as empowerment.
Correct. I think Anita Jay wants to say something. There is on the chat column, there is one particular question. There is a question. Lawyers. Charanya, please cut the noise. Yes, thank you. On the chat column, there is a question. I think it's from a young lawyer, a young lady lawyer. Mm-hmm. She says that the situation is very bad, that even senior clerks are not showing any respect on some young female lawyers. Now, that often happens. Of course, even I have faced it. Now, how does a woman or a young lawyer, a lady lawyer, react to such a situation? She can't, obviously she cannot answer back. And what should be her correct mindset at that time? Should she retort, or should she take it as an experience and grow? What is the honorable panel's view on that?
It's a very to single word I put it, just ignore and go ahead.
take it in your stride. That's one experience you learn. And then prove to the person that you are capable, you are as capable as the male lawyers in the office.
All this, what is spoken?
See, I, Aparna, to make it very clear, to elaborate on that, if the senior clerk has insulted a junior or humiliated a female junior,
yes,
she should not react. She only has to respond. She has to respond in a way what Justice Asha said. She has to rise to the occasion to prove that she is what she is worthy of.
Absolutely. Right?
So if you react and you get upset and you start crying, or you just feel that you are not competent to be in this profession, everything is lost. You just respond. Don't react.
Respond by means of working harder.
Yeah, exactly. Yes.
Thank you so much. I request Mrs. Hema Sampath, Senior Advocate, to come on board. I think she's got a valid point, some questions she's got. Mrs. Hema Sampath, please come in.
So what she gonna do in the courtroom, she wants to do it here.
No. I do the same thing in court and in the house and outside also, and you all know it. So what I have noticed is, in some courts, you cannot send your junior woman lawyer.
Yes.
But you can send your male junior. Because I've seen, and it's not just an impression, I've seen it happen, that judges have also a mental block to listen to young-looking juniors who have thoroughly read the case, and the senior is happy to send them to argue the case. And I found in several, I have experienced it myself in my office. We have a number of young girls working who are working harder and longer hours than some of our male juniors. So I feel judges also need to be sensitized about listening to women lawyers and taking them seriously. Because from your experience sitting on the other side of the bench, you will know that some of us are doing well, the others are just coming there and wasting your time. So once you know that the girl is doing well, the judge should listen to her just as he would give respect to any other lawyer who is addressing him. This is a big problem in our High Court. I don't know whether it is the same, because even when I go to the Supreme Court, I find that a number of young girls who are able to address the Supreme Court itself. But here, the juniors themselves say, ma'am, don't send me to that court.
No.
This is a big problem. I think you have to talk to your male colleagues and tell them that we are serious. And one more thing, how come in 150 years, there was only one female senior lawyer who was designated as senior?
Where? Chennai?
There is some problem with the full court, actually.
There are quite a few.
Narayan Chidambaram was the only senior designated till I, by default, became a senior. And I found that it was very funny, because when I joined in 1983, I have seen Mrs. Radha Gopalan, Mrs. O.K. Sridevi, and several other women who were very senior, who had several senior engagements and were doing very well in court. They were my role models, actually. So I feel there is some block in the minds of male judges also, which prevents women from coming up. I just want the judges to tell me, because now they have been moving with their male colleagues also.
No, see, I mean, the first thing, the way you began the talk, I would differ from that, because you also know, if that was the attitude of the seniors not to send the junior, or if the judges had not encouraged me as a junior, I'm a first generation lawyer. Yes. And the first time I was exposed to your court procedure itself only after I enrolled myself. Unlike what these days these children have, they can come to court even when they are a student, right? So my actually, our seniors were very confident. They only ensured that we read the papers thoroughly and went to the court. They never bothered about the results, be it a dismissal or it get allowed. They say you do justice to what, to the papers, what the bundle, what has been given to you. I would not have even seen the client. He'll address me the bundle, I read it, I go present it. And the judges really encouraged. And they were also, they condescend to our level, to even teach us. They also try to help us where to look at. And Hema madam, you should know this, because both, all of us were there together, right? And if you feel that today some judges, male judges, are not encouraging the juniors, see, it is their problem. How can we here address that?
You could, Mrs. Hema Sampath can definitely go to the court, and if her senior, if her junior has not been heard properly by a judge, she can definitely go there and say that I have sent this junior. I know she is, I'm confident she has read the bundle, she knows the case. So you ought not to have done that. We had examples like Mr. Govind Swaminathan, who would stand up if a junior is insulted in court.
And there were also seniors who never supported the juniors, if I am to say so. I did personally have an experience. I have, Mrs. Hema Sampath also knows that, when one particular judge, when he was sitting for one district, he was holding a district portfolio and for an admission. And he said how, I mean, when I was arguing, earlier I said, no, when you try to be assertive, it was not very well received by them. And he said, a lady junior, your raw junior, how could you address? That was the attitude. But there were several senior lawyers sitting in the court hall. But they were looking at their admission, which were listed next, and not to come to the rescue of the junior who has been, you know, heckled at. So that is also there. You cannot just lay that blame. It is a system. So everyone has to transform, if you are to answer your question.
May I just ask this? You said, your lordship said that you were put
off. My response to the earlier.
Sorry.
I don't want to take specific instances of either judges and seniors encouraging or not encouraging juniors. But the bottom line is performance. And performance is directly related to effort. That's the bottom line. We'll have to work only from that premise.
Now, no, that
taking note of what was conveyed in the query, if there are instances where council are singled for gender on the basis of gender or on the basis of any other irrelevant parameter, it is not correct. That should not be done, and a voice should be raised as to the fact that it is being done, so that that sort of an error is corrected immediately. But from what I can see, at least in the present crop of those of us that I know and fraternize with, we feel that the current crop of juniors, some of them are outstanding. And women, particularly in that, the younger lot, are simply outstanding in the manner they prepare and in the manner that they represent. What is important to a judge is whether there has been a genuine and a bona fide effort to prepare for the matter for that day. There are any number of instances where we have young counsel who come merely to seek an adjournment because that is their instruction. Their instruction is only to seek an adjournment. We appreciate that. But, and we have said this ad infinitum in courts as well, you cannot be guaranteed of an adjournment when you make that request.
Absolutely.
That what one expects is that whatever an instruction may be that is given to a counsel is prepared to the best of his or her ability. That's the bottom line. Nothing more, nothing less. Thereafter, the court is always, should always be willing to listen, give a margin for youth, give a margin for over-enthusiasm, give a margin for various other lacunae that may step in. But if the court is convinced that the counsel has prepared the matter and is making an honest-to-God attempt to represent in the best manner possible, then I think that counsel is won over. And I think that should be the effort that is made by every young counsel when he or she goes to a court. Carry your bundle. There are many instances where counsels also don't come with bundles to court.
Yes, yes.
Sometimes it pains us to see that it is taken so casually. If we see that a counsel is taking things seriously, be it a woman, be it a male, they are taking things seriously and they are putting the best efforts possible. That's all that is needed. That's my take.
I agree with Justice Anita Sumant on that. The one crop of juniors were really well prepared. Even if they come first, ask for an adjournment, the minute we ask them questions, they are able to answer. But there is a sizable amount of juniors, both male as well as female, who refuse to say anything beyond, I want an adjournment. And that really puts you off. Because, you know, you come, most of us read the bundles and we come to the court. And we find that the juniors are not showing any inclination to do the work. That is when that is when we refuse to listen to them. But I think by and large, if we find a junior has read the bundle, we listen to them, and thereafter we are ready to accommodate them and give them an adjournment. If there is a chance of us thinking that we have to dismiss the case, we don't want the dismissal to go in the name of the junior, we are ready to do that. But what we expect is only that the junior makes the representation. Not parrot-like repeat, I want an adjournment, my senior is ill, I want an adjournment. Most of the people just come saying the senior is ill. I would have seen the senior walking down the corridor.
No, but I have a point on this, sorry. What happens is, some very encouraging officers give the bundles to the juniors, make them prepare, and then say you just seek an adjournment, but suppose the judge wants you to argue, just go ahead. But there are some other seniors, what they do is they give the bundle in the last minute and then ask the junior to take an adjournment. Therefore, probably that also could be a reason.
No, we could always sense that as judges sitting on the podium, we'll know whether the junior is made a scapegoat for the day. So if that is so, but if the junior has really well read the papers, we would allow them to go, and in turn, we will not allow the senior to come and argue. We will only tell them, even if they are not 100% prepared or if they want to do further investigation, we will give them time. We also make note in the name of the counsel, the junior counsel who is representing. We would ensure that the senior does not come and appear. He may come and stand next to him, but we will not allow him to argue. See, that is how we want to encourage. See, we all have grown up only that way.
Yes.
Right? But for the encouragement given by the judges and our seniors, we would not be here today.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Therefore, now I think we are slightly deviating from the topic. Like, it is generally about the juniors, including both male and female.
No, but this actually caters more to women juniors. In fact, I just wanted to develop on the point that your lordship had said. The lordship had said that you were put off by a judge when actually you were prepared and you were ready.
Correct, correct.
So what was your mental state? Were you terrified? See, what happens is...
No, not at all. Not at all. Even before you could... Yes, I am not at all. Because, you know, as I said, the judge used to hold a portfolio of a particular district. And we had majority of the cases from that district. So day in and out, we used to get at least three admissions like that. And the first day I got 2 dismissals. My senior said, never bother. If you feel that you have done your best, don't bother about the results at all. Because each case has got its own journey. So the journey of that case has ended there. So he said not to worry about it. The next day again, when 2 matters were listed, he just looked at my face. I said, give sir, I can go and do it.
Your lordship is trying to say that no matter what, whoever puts you off, you have to wait through it and then have guts to again go before the very same judge, probably get kicked off again also. But then
that particular judge, whatever doubts he used to have, even when you are sitting in the court hall, he'll ask us and get himself clarified. Right? See, that is how you should take it. Why should you get put off? Because if the judge is not going to agree, maybe the other side also will not agree with you on a particular point. But because merely it is a judge who is putting the question, you need not get terrorized at all. You just take it with a pinch of salt, then get on to the next point and go ahead.
There's also the social embarrassment, because there are many seniors sitting in the court hall. And especially for women, because see, after so much of pressure, family pressure, they come there. And when the judge also ticks them off, and it becomes very difficult for them to come out of that, the terrified state. So your lordship says that you should not get terrified. You have to build yourself into so much of strength and stamina.
Yes.
Yes.
Because you're representing somebody. You're wearing a black gown. Yes. Only when you're representing, you're wearing the gown. Otherwise, you remove the gown. So once you wear it, you are the client. Yes. It is not Aparna, it is not Maithili, or it is not Pushpa.
Yes.
Yes. It is the client behind you for whom you are asking. So you are only, that's why you call it as a wakalat. Yes. So on wakalat, you are representing somebody's cause. So once you get disturbed, your thought process will be distorted.
Yes.
Therefore, you should not allow your thought process to get disturbed at all. So these are all external, influences.
Yeah.
And, yes.
This is so important for all lawyers and particularly the juniors to learn this. It's a very, very vital lesson. And this also shows what an important role good seniors play in grooming their juniors past all this. It's not about winning or losing a case. So... And it's about putting in the right amount of effort, going into every detail and being ready for every question that could be answered. I think this is rather...
Yeah, yes. There's a question from one of the participants. Can I read that to the honorable panelists?
Yes.
Very good morning to all the esteemed judges. Just wanted to understand how your lordships, being women, spaced out time for reading and enhancing your knowledge. It's a very pertinent question.
Yes. See, even I haven't perceived the question first, but I want to answer it. Okay. See, this is because when you have, the time is very short in your hands, you try to complete everything. See, I was basically a sports person. So when I was in college, I had to go for my practice and come back with what little time available. I'll have to prepare my assignments. I'll have to be ready for the next day's test, everything. So there's no time to think of anything else other than doing this. Therefore, here as a woman, maybe with a small infant also at home, if she comes here, completes her case, get back to work, how, see, because there is no time, would she stop feeding her child?
Yeah, of course. Right? Absolutely,
so, you'll have to distribute your time.
Yes.
You'll have to allocate this. I mean, I don't believe in grumbling that I don't have time.
Absolutely. That's very
management is all.
Precisely. Yes.
See, it's a question of prioritizing.
Priority. Yes, you're right.
What you think is important. I remember the day I joined, I asked my senior very naively, I asked him, what are my working hours in the office? And his response was, all your waking hours are working hours.
that's a nice one. Yes.
Beautiful.
What you do in your working hours is you may read, you may study, you may take care of your child, you may cook, you may garden, you may do whatever is important. But the productive and the constructive use of your time is what one will mean by working hours. So it's your priority. Time is yours. It's in your hands, and it's for you to do what you believe is the best use that you can deploy it.
Very inspirational. Very.
Yeah, to improve on that question,
yes.
I think the person who had asked the question, how you equip yourself with the, or update yourself with the latest cases reported, etc. See, as the journals are being purchased either by herself or himself or by the junior, I mean the senior, or even it is there in the library. Definitely not that 24/7 you are working, or in the court hours, all the 3+3 hours you are there in the court hall. You have ample time to waste. That yes, that time you can go to the library, just at least go through the journals. Then even whichever is more interesting to you, you can make note of it and give it a deep reading. See, that is how you can, see, it is not that you have to go home, have a session for reading, and then do the next work. It is not going to work out. Or you can even carry the journals. When they are coming in parts, you can carry it in hand, wherever you are, you can sit. Nowadays, everything is on fingertips. There, earlier, our days, to have it in fingertips, we had to put in so much of efforts. But today, you have everything in fingertips. You just have the click of the button, everything is there, wherever you are. So I don't think it should be very difficult for you. So as Anita put it,
a very valid point that in the scheme of practice that we have nowadays,
yes,
one spends more time waiting for a matter to be called rather than actually waiting for the arguing the matter itself.
Correct.
And that's so much of time when you think of it at the end of the day. That time is something that can really be put well to use. Carry a book, carry a diary. I have seen several counsel in my court who carry their iPads, take notes, who do their correction, they correct their opinions, they correct briefs, they read in court. So that is really a large chunk of time that you can put to good use.
Yes, that is also counted as your working hours.
Yes. Asha Ji, your take on this?
Same. I only got to concur with my sisters there. I have no other. Nothing else to say. Like how they say, your time in the court, especially when you're waiting for a case, instead of chatting with your friends, which happens to be the favorite pastime of many juniors, you can productively use it by reading in the court, doing whatever work you can. We have done that. It is as if we are asking the juniors to do something which we have not practiced. We have done that. So that's the answer. Young lady's question.
Thank you. Mr. T. Ramesh, who's a senior member of the Madras Tax Bar, has a question. Mr. T. Ramesh, can you please come on board? Can you read the, it's a very pertinent question there. Yeah, it's a statement, it's a very pertinent statement actually. Mr. Ramesh?
Yeah.
You can put yourself on video, yes.
Yeah, good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon.
Yeah, I feel, before my daughter has also completed her law recently, I feel some system has to be in place to train or to coach the juniors or the new entrant before entering into the profession, such that, you know, they will be having, because now they are in the cusp of the older generation, the new generation. So it will be better for them to have a coaching before entering into. I feel that some system is to be created for train them before getting into. Or it can be in the curriculum itself. The last few months, they can be trained with the lectures of the experienced seniors or those who appear in the courts. That's what my feeling is.
See, any forced idea will not work out. If you are aware, earlier we had the system of apprenticeship. That is, after your completion, you will have to be with a lawyer and for 6 months or 1 year. Then only after your apprenticeship is complete and the senior lawyer certifies, you may even enroll and come. So you get into inculcating the traits in you. Yes, so you are well trained, right from the method of learning, your etiquette in the court, everything is taught. But here that system is now taken away. They have something called bar examination, and they simply write the examination and get away with that. This may be, you may also make a request to the bar council to introduce that system, that a compulsory an apprenticeship with a senior is should be there. Only thereafter you can enroll.
Before we just move on to the next question, I request all the other participants other than the panelists and the coordinators and any person who's asked to come on board, please switch off the video. It's a little disturbing. When you're asked to come on board, you can switch on the video. Thank you.
To Ramesh's question, Aparna.
Yes.
The present system, in fact, today, you know, in our times, we had the system of joining offices. How many of our lectures you might listen to? Unless and until you have a practical experience, you just cannot learn the profession. The system of straight starting your independent practice without having a basic training under a senior, I think that you definitely need training under some office which is there, which is an established office. You have to at least practice as a junior for 2-3 years for you to really learn the profession, to at least understand the profession. I wouldn't have to understand what the profession is. Deal with clients, how to deal with a case, you definitely need that practice. That is one thing which
it was not very audible.
Very good. Question is not audible. Ramesh's question was not audible.
Ramesh?
Yes.
Can you repeat your question? I think
the question was the question whether one can set up individual practice immediately after enrollment. What was the question? I'm sorry.
It was not a question. My suggestion was, it was a suggestion rather than a question.
I'm sorry, I'm not able to hear it.
My suggestion was, hello.
So his suggestion is, should there be a training immediately after they pass out as lawyers? Should there be a training in terms of something like what we had apprenticeship? Or maybe even as in maybe the final year or something like that. I think that is this question.
I think that has been answered by my colleagues. Just yes. To come to that, there is whether one has such a training mandatorily or not. It's not mandatory because students nowadays have so many internships in the course of their study itself that they do get some kind of a bird's eye view as to how practices, what is working in a firm all about. So that much is there. But whether one would talk about mandatory training or otherwise, the value that is attached to working with the senior before you strike out on your own is simply something that one cannot emphasize on enough, particularly some senior who has been in practice, established in any field of any branch of the law, to know how he thinks, to know what the principles, ethics, and values of the profession are. They are the bridge. And unfortunately, today we don't have too many of the officers and seniors who are able to take juniors under their wings and train them. But in the interest of all juniors, it is necessary that they attach themselves. It would be really worth their while to attach themselves to some junior who has been in practice for a length of time. Assimilate old practices, values, systems, and you know, as far as new practices, technology, etc. is concerned, juniors nowadays have all these benefits that are there. Therefore, it is necessary that they know the old time-tested values and principles as well. Marry them with new concepts, new thoughts, new ways of thinking, and then strike out on your own. I think that will enrich them far more.
Ramesh, you're not audible.
Yeah, empower them, empowering the junior. You can tell
yes. Yes, yes. Thank you, Ramesh.
Thank you.
Lordships, I have one question on this. Are your lordships, do your lordships have any comment on the dress code of women? I mean, how exactly should they be? Because as a lawyer, I see many of them coming in flashy outfits, and you know, it doesn't look good according to me. So what is your lordships, because your lordships are sitting at an elevated level and your lordship will have definitely, I mean, it kind of distracts the court proceedings is one thing. And secondly, there should be some kind of a solemnity that has to be maintained. So what is your lordship's take on that?
Isn't that not prescribed in the Bar Council rules? Yes, it is there,
of course it
very
is.
Much
of
in place.
Of so course.
Who is to, I mean, we cannot keep pulling out lawyers who are coming in such flashy outfit. That is not our job. Yes. So this has to be, the associations can take care of, or the Bar Council can address it, make it more rigid. That's all we can say.
Yes, yes, my lord. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Now, if I may pose another question to your lordships. Is it women in authority are either deified or demonized? Is it not possible just to look at them as they are? I mean, is it an experience that you've had? You're either the goddess or somebody who is who's found to be more harsh than you actually are, just because she's being assertive or in a position of authority.
See, women empowerment. That is how this question arises. So, an empowered woman, how she is being received by the society. Am I right? Did I get you right?
Yes.
That's right.
See, I don't know if I am to say, we take the men as a standard. Okay? That is itself a very wrong approach.
Absolutely.
Men are men and women are women.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes. Supposing a CEO of a company is a woman, a CEO of a company is a man, how does it matter?
It should matter.
Yes. So, the authority what the man has and what he exhibits, the same authority is extended by the woman CEO also. So, for comparing, there is no comparison at all. Women are women and men are men. Men cannot be the standard for the women. Because many times women can do much better than men.
Though we are
said to be the fairer sex and the weaker sex also. Yes. So,
yes.
Setting the standard of a man and comparing it for women, I will not agree.
How do we break the stereotype is my question. Is there, how do we go about, I mean, because it means a better gender sensitization or gender neutrality?
My answer will be my opening statement. Like, it is not that who is allowing you to go. You go, you do it, that's all. Nobody stops you. Who stops you? You just get going.
I agree.
Yes.
Yes, Asha.
Anita wants to say something.
Anita ji.
See, as far as standards are concerned, they are universal. But unfortunately, it is a truth that society does demand higher standards from a woman in order to recognize their merit. That's the truth. Well, if that kind of demand is made, in my view, one should rise to the challenge and one should meet it. That's as far as that is concerned. Now, you spoke about deification and demonization, etc. That's one instance only comes to mind. India has always had a very peculiar approach to empowerment of women. See, we tend to revere women, we tend to put them on a pedestal and we call them Shakti, we call them goddesses. I said this earlier when I spoken in other platforms. But I was speaking in a gender sensitization conference recently, and one of the speakers there said, I don't know why we say that we don't respect women in India. In fact, when we go out to battle, we always ask the woman of the house to put a tikka on our forehead, and it's only after taking their blessings that we go out. Very good, that's true. But how long did it take to allow that woman to go alongside of a man and do battle? That's the difference. You place her on a pedestal, you call her Shakti, you ask her to bless you when you go to do battle. But it is only in 2020, 17th of February 2020, that the Supreme Court said that women can have permanent commissions in the Indian Army. That's the difference. And therefore, one is talking about deification and demonization, etc. My only response would be, I think we've covered this ground even earlier. It really requires a change in the mindset of society, and it's a long drawn out process, and it's a work in progress. Let's hope we get there eventually. That's my response.
And in this regard, I just only want to quote Alice Walker, an American writer. She says, the most common way people give up their power is by thinking that they don't have any. Yes, so the women has all powers.
So yes. True. The name is power. Yes.
And that's it.
Exactly.
It's a beautiful take on this. Beautiful. Asha Jay.
See, for me as a judge, I don't require either to be, vilified or glorified. Ultimately, my judgment that is going to stalk. Whether I'm a male judge, whether I'm a female judge, ultimately it's my judgments that are going to speak. Therefore, I don't know. I'm really not able to understand this concept. I mean, like how Anita said, yes, that's one view of taking it. But as a judge, I think ultimately it is only your judgment that counts. Nothing more than that. So I don't think we need to dwell on it.
I think Anita Jay's. Yes, there is one chat from one intern, Asha Jay's intern, I think. Yes, there was a lot to learn from this panel, especially as an aspiring woman lawyer myself. Thank you so much for the invaluable guidance. Honored and blessed to have interned under Justice P.T. Asha. That is Vijeta Ravi. I just wanted to bring this to your notice.
Thanks.
Just one last question, which is actually in line. One is, your lordships have actually taken the whole discussion in a positive manner, and no question of feeling victimized or anything. It is for us, it's up to us to forward and do what we have to and believe in ourselves. And taking it that on the same lines is my contrarian question, that by pushing our case for a better representation in the judiciary, are we working at cross purposes with the cause? Why are we talking about numbers anymore? It is merit that matters. Why does it matter whether we are a woman or a man? We just have to get better and get selected. That is.
Yes, Pushpa.
Yeah, I'm there.
So what is, I would just like to have your lordship's views on whether we should at all push for larger numbers and better representation, because we don't want to be identified as women. So what does it matter whether less women? And why should we say we are better or worse? It does, there's nothing like better or worse, because we're all the same human beings. So why do we shouldn't be losing sight, which is exactly contrary to the, you know, the focus of the topic, which is supposed to be about women.
We are talking about women empowerment and you know, cross purposes on gender neutrality at the same time. Yes. But I suppose you work hand in hand. Your lordship,
the other side. Your lordship could enlighten us.
No, I come again.
I think we've answered this question and dealt with it earlier.
Do we push for greater representation at all, is my question. Or should we just drop this whole thing and just keep working it by better?
See, pushing ourselves, see, like...
Yes.
One way of ensuring that representation is greater, and that would be the best way. That's all I can say. One way to concentrate solely on bettering oneself, upping one's standards, that would be the best way of ensuring that there is better representation.
And merit comes into place once voices through merit, and you prove yourself, you work and you prove yourself, definitely you're going to be recognized.
Yes. No, but proving oneself and you know, getting recognized is I would say it would be third stage. But the second stage is encouragement, grit to stay in the profession. And the first stage is, of course, entry. That is the entry level. There should be a proportionate entry of women qua men. That is the first level. The second, yes, sorry, Miller. Lordship had something to say.
No.
Yes. So second level, as your lordship put it, the she imperative is very important. It was beautifully Ajay. That she imperative is very important. You have to believe in yourself. Don't get just because any particular judge ticks you off. That is very important. And third, of course, is absolute dedication and hard work, no matter what comes in your way. Absolute concentration into the work and the will and the wish for achievement. I think the panelists have beautifully put it, very beautifully put it. We have actually come to the almost the end of the session. And before that, I would have to say that your lordships, as three judges, the full bench has created history in the 150 years of Madras High Court. We congratulate your lordships on this. And of course, we are much thankful to the Honorable Chief Justice of the Madras High Court for making this a historical moment for the lady judges of the Madras High Court, as also the Madras High Court as well. Lordships, in fact, I really thank your lordships for taking your time and coming in and giving us so much of valuable inputs. And I think I'm seeing so much of chats that everyone has benefited. They want your lordships to even, help them to write a book on this. I do not know how that is possible, because your lordships are so busy. I don't know how that is possible, but that's a beautiful thought that is coming in. And of course, I must, thinking of the team that has worked, what has happened is for the past 1 week, Maitri and I have been on this constantly exchanging notes, exchanging questions and everything. But before that, there's a pillar of a man who's standing behind this. That is Mr. A.P. Srinivas. He needs a very special mention. In fact, he's a dear of the darling of Madras Tax Bar, because he's been after these. We have been having a lot of webinars from April 11th or April 20th or something. And we've already had 15 webinars on various subjects. And he has been a pillar to the Madras Tax Bar, because he's been giving us ideas and structuring the, he says, why don't you do, he was the one who suggested this, why don't you do an all-women's panel? And it has come out very beautifully. Thanks a lot to Mr. A.P. Srinivas and Mr. Raghavan, who has been at this WebEx, because I was very particular. All the other meetings were through Zoom, but I was very particular that this particular meeting has to be done only through WebEx. And Mr. Raghavan, who is a very important member of the Madras Tax Bar, has helped us. So thank you very much, and thank you to all the participants who posed beautiful questions. Of course, we could not address each and every question because of paucity of time. Thank you very much to the panelists and very much obliged to your lordships. Thank you.
Thank you for giving us an opportunity. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.